Good evening, everyone. This is for Leilui Nishmat.
Nedar bat Nana.
Nedar bat
Nana.
As the beautiful Bukharian custom, when the annual date of the Yortzeit, when people passed away, Baruch Hashem, in all the places, Jews gather together to pay respect to the deceased person, but by the communities here, it's always in a much higher level, Baruch Hashem, and people always come to pay respect, very good. The question that we have to ask, many people come to Yortzeit, every year they come, their grandfather passed away, the father, the brother, every year they come to give respect. They come together, thank you, they come together, and they come, they eat, they talk, they laugh, they enjoy the ashpolor. And almost nobody asks, what are we doing here? What are we doing here? If my grandfather passed away, if my grandfather passed away 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, What am I doing? Coming to a restaurant to eat good food and laugh and enjoy. What does it do to him? If he became sand, he doesn't know I'm here. Right? So why would I'm wasting my time coming sometime from Florida to New York, from here to Israel, or going standing in a cemetery by a piece of a rock? Why people do such stupid things? It looks very stupid. Ma, you're talking to the sand. You're talking to the plate. The person that became nothing, it became sand. It doesn't help him anything that we gather together and you bring a rabbi and the rabbi say something. Where all these things come from? Logically, if people do not know about God and the Torah, the Russian communists, if you show them that somebody died 10 years ago and the kids of this person come to eat together and to talk, they say, we're crazy. These people are crazy, shugaim. What are they doing? Wasting their time, wasting money, paying for food. What are they doing, these Jews? The person, some of them take the body and they throw it to the fish. The fish ate the body. Or they burn it, they put it inside the jar, and they put it on the shelf. So if you see a little bit ashes here, you come to talk to the wall, what does it help if you talk? Here is the ashes right here. Dad, father, grandfather, we came to tell you how much we love you and we miss you. Who are you talking to? You're talking to the wall. Did you ever think what we're doing? And you know, the Jewish people are not so stupid. Usually they're very smart. Usually they are the smartest in the world. Usually they are the smartest in the history of the world. No nation donated or contributed to the world more than the Jews, percentage-wise. The Jews are only 13.2 million people in the world, and they contribute to the world more than 7.5 billion Gentiles. Check the Nobel Prize winner list. Half of them are Jewish. The Jews are not half of the world. Check in United States. In United States, how many doctors you have? Half of the doctors in United States are Jewish. But the Jews are only 6 million in United States. There's 400 million Gentiles. 400 million contributed 50% of the doctors. 6 million gave the same amount. It's more or less the same when it comes to lawyers and judges and scientists and the rest of the things. They're very educated people, very successful relatively to the amount of people that they are. The Jews contributed to the world everything. But what is the most important thing that the Jews contributed to the world? The Book of God, the Torah. Who said it? You heard about Muhammad? Muhammad, that started the Quran, he called the Jews the nation of the book. Am HaSefer. In Hebrew it sounds good. Am HaSefer, the nation that brought the world the book. The book, the most important book ever. The book of the creator of the world. Without the Jews, not the Christians and not the Muslims will know anything about God. Nothing. Zero. The Christian will not know who God is. They wouldn't know he's the God of heaven. They would never know about body and soul. They will never know about heaven and hell. They will never know the concept of reward and punishment. They will never know about the concept of Messiah. All of that they learn in a Jewish book, the Torah. Without it, the Christian wouldn't know anything about religion. Later, they wrote another book and they continue from there. But all the foundation of Christianity all come from what they call the Old Testament, which we call the Torah. Same book, we're talking about the same book. Whether it's in Hebrew, the original language, or whether it's in English, or whether it's in Russian, it doesn't make a difference, it's the same meaning. The Muslims, same story. Why the Muslim call themselves Ibrahim? Abraham, Abraham. Why they call themselves Ismail? Ishmael, the son of Abraham, Ishmael, Ismail. Why they call themselves Yusuf? Yusuf, Yosef, everything comes from the Torah. Why the Muslim wants the cave of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Why? In Hebron, they demonstrate, they shoot, they kill. They don't want Jews to come there. Why they build the mosque where the Jewish temple used to be, by the Western Wall? All the things that they do, why they don't eat pork? Why they don't charge interest for one from another? Where did they learn all these laws from? They learn it from the Torah. Without the Torah, there wouldn't be any Islam. If there was no Torah, there would not be no Christianity, no Islam, and many of the other religions and cults that came later. What does it teach you? Without the Jews, the world will be 99.9% different, even in technology today. Somebody made a film, Boycott Israel. They want to boycott Israel, right? Let's not buy anything from Israel. So somebody else made the film. Let's see how your life would be with boycotting Israel. And they started to show all the Israeli inventions of the last 20, 30 years. Basically, if you take it out of the world, we will go back 1,000 years back. You wouldn't have iPhone, you wouldn't have laptops, you wouldn't have computer hospital equipment. You would not have GPS, you would not have anything. Everything almost the Israelis invent today. Intel, Microsoft, Apple, they all have big companies in Israel, build buildings, thousands of Israeli brains, and they invent everything. Microsoft is an Israeli kid. He invented Windows and sold it to Bill Gates for $600,000-$700,000, that's it. And today worth $100 billion. And many other things, the processors of Intel, everything is Israeli inventions. Even when I was in the army, when I was in the Air Force, we used to buy F-16 airplanes from United States. They are the best in making war airplanes, United States, the best. Russians also pretty good, but United States have the best reputation to make airplanes. But we, the Israelis, when we used to buy the F-16 from America, the price back then when I was, that was 27 years ago, 28 years ago. Today maybe it's double. Back then the price of an F-16 was $50 million. 50 million. Every airplane's F-16, 50 million used to be. When we got it from America and it arrived to Israel, it came with panels. There's panels with screws around. You open all the screws, you open the panel, there's some kind of a big, massive computer inside. Every airplane that came, my job and my friends was to take all the American equipment out, replace it all with Israeli equipment. Don't ask questions. Open the plugs, take out all the American things, put it out. I don't know what they did with that. Put Israeli instead. Why? 100 times better. Nothing to compare what they invent to what we invent. The world doesn't do it. When they sell it to Saudi Arabia, it's the same airplane. They sell it to Egypt, same one. Comes to Israel, they change everything. The Israeli only buy the plane. They don't want to waste time building it. They just put their own software inside and make it a lot better. This is how it is. The Jewish mind, as the Torah promised, will dominate the world. Will dominate the world. But just to be smart and to have talent, it's not always good. It depends what you do with this talent. Some Jews, they help the world very much. They invented medicine, technology, things that made life a lot greater and a lot better. Some Jews invented things that destroying the world. With the same brain that the creator of the world gave Isaac and Moshe, one of them did good to the world and the other one is destroying the world. They have the same IQ, same intelligence. One chose to be righteous, one chose to be wicked. The choices that we make is 100% in our hand. Everything else, nothing else is in our hand. Nobody asks you if you be a man or a woman. Nobody asks you who will be your parents. Nobody asks you if you want to be healthy or you want to be sick. Nobody asks you if you want to be wealthy or poor. If you want to be smart or foolish. None of these things you decided. There's only one thing you decide. Only one thing. What you have, you have. Nobody asks you. This is what your creator gave you. What to do with what you got is 100% your decision. If you have a sharp brain, you're supposed to use it correctly. Do things to help the world, to make the world better. Don't use the sharp brain to be a professional crook, to steal billions of dollars from people, or to make atomic bombs to destroy millions of people. That's not what I gave you the brain for. I gave you this gift to help the world, to be a big rabbi, to teach Torah, to teach the purpose of life, to teach how to raise children, to teach how to be married, how to do business honestly. This is what I gave you this brain for, to cure people. This is what you have it for. You don't have it to do bad, you have it to do good. So I started to ask, when I started my speech tonight here, I ask, what is these strange things that we do, that every year we come back together, we spend money, we talk, we smile, we laugh, and we eat a lot, and then we go home and we think, or we feel at least, we feel very good. How are you, Isaac? Baruch Hashem, I'm very good. Why are you so happy? I just made a big evening for my father. Everybody came, we say nice words about him, or my mother. So I feel very good. What are you feeling good? You're talking to the wall. You're crazy. What did you do good in the world? You came to a place, your father is nothing, he's sand. You're talking to the air. Who heard you, Bichlal? Why you spend $1,000, $2,000, $5,000 for the food? What are you doing? You're stupid. Do something better. Take your time and your money and do something better. Your father is history. Right or wrong? The answer, of course, wrong. But how do we know it's wrong? That's the question. If you take a secular Jew, what we call in Hebrew, Chiloni, and you ask him, prove to me that what we're doing here tonight, gathering together and speaking for the dead person, that we are not stupid and talking to the wall, prove to me, he won't be able to prove. He will say, you know what? Actually, I think you're right. We're really not normal, what we're doing. I don't know why we're doing it. We're doing it. I don't know. My father did it. My grandfather did it. I'm also doing it. Is this what we're supposed to do? Just because people do things we're supposed to also do? Many people do bad things, so that means we're supposed to do the same thing. The answer, Rabotai, we, the Jewish people, 3,300 years ago approximately, we were very lucky to stand in a place called Mount Sinai. Millions of people that came out of Egypt. 7 weeks later, they stood by the mountain and they received the Book of God in a public event. It never happened in history again that God came to a group of people. Never. many of the religions that started after Judaism, it was always a story of one person. Muhammad came and claimed that the angel Gabriel gave him the Quran. How many people saw it? Nobody. Not even one witness. It's his story. Believe it or not, it's up to you. One day Mary had a dream. She was pregnant. Her husband came away after a while. He wasn't home. He never touched her. He see that his wife gained weight a little bit. So he said to her, I don't understand. I left you skinny. Why are you like this? She said, what, you suspect me? I didn't cheat on you. God came to me in a dream. He made me pregnant. And this boy will be very holy. I'm still a virgin. I never did anything wrong. Now he had two options, to believe her and let go, or to turn her into the Jewish court. Remember, they were both Jewish. They were both Jewish. Yosef and Miriam. In English, Joseph and Mary. It's the same people. Jose and Maria. You understand? It's the same people, no? So, Yosef and Miriam. Yosef was a carpenter. He got married. He left. He came back after a while. He see, Baruch Hashem, she's ready to give birth. He said to her, this is not my son. She said, don't worry. It's much better than your son. It's the son of God. He made me pregnant. And then she gave birth. He, of course, if he would turn her in, they would execute her. Because according to the Torah, a married woman went with another man, it's death penalty. So obviously he loved her. He didn't want to see her getting killed. So he stayed with her. They got married. They continued the marriage. And JC was born. And he went to yeshiva. And then when he was a teenager, he got kicked out of the yeshiva of Rav Yoshua ben Parchia. And then later on, since he wasn't in yeshiva anymore, they put him on a ban. He started to collect people from the street, started to teach them the Torah that he knew. Still was putting tefillin every day, he had bar mitzvah, everything. He was teaching all the miserable people on the streets, collecting them, made himself a group, people that nobody looked at. And somehow, he started a little cult. And then, when he died like a Jew. He never started a new religion. He died as a Jew. Nobody liked him because he went against the normal way of Judaism. But he never said or never dared to say, I'm here to start a new religion or to contradict the old one. The opposite. In the book of Matthew, which is from the New Testament, he writes clearly over there, I don't come to contradict the Torah. I did not come to contradict the Torah. I came to fulfill. If heaven and earth would be destroyed, no one can still erase one letter from this holy Torah. Anyone that will change one letter of this Torah and will teach it differently to other people will be cursed by the kingdom of heaven. You don't have a better statement than this. I didn't come here to make a new religion. I'm still a Jew, and that's the truth. Something went wrong. After he died, it's big arguments. Between 70 to 300 years after he died, they started a new religion called Christianity. In the beginning, nobody was interested in it. What's in it? You have to believe that he's the Messiah. We're not interested. They couldn't do anything with that until they saw that the Romans, they don't have a religion. The Romans, they came to the Romans, join us. The Romans say, we don't believe in what you believe. You believe in circumcision, we're against it. It's defecting the body. And they say, okay, what else you don't believe? They say, we don't believe in not working on a Sabbath. Every day you don't work, you lose money, you're not productive. You have every week a day off? We're not interested. We're here to work, to succeed. They say, no problem. That's it? Everything else you okay with? They say, fine. Okay, we'll cancel those two things. You join us? They say, fine. They moved the Shabbat to Sunday. Shabbat was canceled. All the laws of Shabbat got canceled. Until then, they kept Shabbat, just like we keep. And they did Brit Milah to the kids in the 8 days. They canceled the Brit Milah. And that's how Christianity became today, close to 2 billion people. This is the story of this religion. But it's all based on the story of one woman. You either believe her dream or you don't believe her dream. But it's right away, 50% doubt. Same thing Muhammad, same thing Krishna, same thing Buddha. They all came and Buddha came. I saw the light. I had an enlightenment. How many people were with you when you saw the light? No one. I was alone. The difference between all these religions to the real religion, the book of God, the first one, the original one, which is the Torah, is that God gave the Torah to the Jews in a public event. All the millions of Jews were there and heard him and Moshe Rabbeinu speaking word by word. Everybody heard it, as it's written in the Torah. And all the Jews got so scared, and they said to Moshe, please go up to the mountain, speak yourself to this God, because we cannot take it. We are dying here. And Moshe answered, don't worry, God did not come to hurt you here. It's all a test. He's giving you today his agreement, his covenant. Everybody here must follow his ways and listen to his instruction for your own good. If you listen to him, one day you're going to get rewarded. You go against him, you're going to get punished. That's what life is all about. How many Jews follow it? Today, 3,300 years later, I'm very sad to announce that 70% of the Jewish people in the world, not only they're not religious, they don't even know one word of religion. They cannot say one word in religion. You ask him, hey, Itzik, where are you from? Tel Aviv. Can you tell me 1 minute speech about Torah? 1 minute. He doesn't even know who Avraham Avinu is. Go in Tel Aviv, ask every Israeli on the street, tell me please, when did we get the Torah? Most likely he won't know in Mount Sinai. Ask him why we celebrate Pesach. He won't know. What's Rosh Hashanah? He would say New Year's Eve, a beginning of a new year. But what's Rosh Hashanah? He won't know. It's the judgment day. He won't know. I'm telling you from experience. I get the questions from these people. When they hear me for the first time, they get the shock of their life. I gave now in Israel 1 million CDs. Everywhere you go in Israel, everywhere, gas station, restaurant, you're going to find the CDs. People put them all over. We cover Israel like rain. People, they are Israeli genius people. They know computer, they're big doctors, judges in a court. They get curious. They see a CD, the purpose of life. So they think, I don't even know what the purpose of life. Let's see what this CD is about. He puts it in a car. He drives 5-10 minutes, and he begins to get the shock of his life. Wow, I didn't know there is a God. I didn't know he gave the Torah. I didn't know I'm something special because I'm a Jew. I didn't even know I have a soul. I didn't even know this soul is one day going to come out and that's what's going to cause my body to die. I didn't know the soul will go to a good place or to a bad place. I didn't even know that there is such a thing, reward and punishment and a judgment. I didn't even know that everything that I do, God is recording and everything will be documented by the seconds. Nobody can run away from him. Jews and non-Jews, everybody stand in a trial when they die. Some of the Gentiles, they're righteous. They go to heaven. Heaven of Gentiles. Some of the Jews, they go to heaven of Jews. Some of the Gentiles go to hell of Goyim, of Gentiles. Some of the Jews go to hell of Jews. And there's some other punishments. Depend what you did. You kept Shabbat or no? Shabbat is the eternal covenant between the Jewish nation and God. He did not put us here to eat barbecue. Hey, come by my pool, Shabbat, I'm going to fry some, I'm going to barbecue some steaks. Everybody come, beer. So what's you doing? How is business? That's not what I put you here. If that was the purpose of life, I would make you a monkey. Monkey has a wife, has children, live for free, doesn't have to work 30 years for the mortgage, doesn't have to put a show. He's jumping on the trees, he's jumping into the lake, to the water. We have a fantastic life. What the monkey has, we work all year to go to the Poconos. Maybe we'll swim a little bit, a boat, jumping a little bit, sport, something, we'll eat good. The monkey has it for free all his life. What? He doesn't have problems. You ever saw a monkey with gray hair? You ever saw monkey that need plastic surgeries? You ever saw a depressed monkey? You ever saw a bald monkey? You ever saw monkey on Prozac? Never. We the only one that suffer. The animals have it very easy. Nice, enjoy. Look, you look at the dogs in your backyard. You throw a little ball on the grass. How he's excited, like he won the lottery. This is it. People do not even know why we live here for. Most of the people, ask them, excuse me, Mr. X, Mr. Y, can you tell me the purpose of life? No idea. So once these Israelis or American Jews, they pick up these CDs and they begin to listen, they look at the CD and they see an email. Some of them, of course, not all, right away, they pick up the phone and they type an email. Dear Rabbi, I just pick up your CD in a gas station. Out of curiosity, I've been listening, and 3 days I do not come out of my car already. I see it, I cannot stop listening. You prove to me that my whole life was one big mistake. But where do I start? I didn't even know how lucky I am to be a Jew, and I didn't even know there is life after death. Everything in a CD is so clear. Everything is so easy. People don't know. How did he know? They put him in public school. What did he learn in public school? What did he learn? Did he learn to respect his parents? Did he learn to kiss his father's hand when he comes home? Did he learn to stand up when his father comes in? Did he learn to appreciate what he gets in life? What did he learn to be? He learned that it's mitzvah to be a gay. That's what he learned in public school. Very good. It's 100% right. That's the right way. Why you want to be a man and a woman? Don't be primitive. There's no world today. This is what's good. That's what they tell. This professor is like this. What do you want him to teach him? You understand what's going on? We, the Jewish people, we receive the book of God. Today, we have very difficult time to understand the book of God. One, we're not intelligent enough in religion. We don't have background. We never learned since we young. Look at the religious boys. When they're 5, 6 years old, they already know 10 times more than secular Jews that are 80 years old. Take a judge in a Supreme Court in the United States, a Jewish judge. Take a Jewish judge in a Supreme Court in Tel Aviv or Jerusalem. Bring him, and I promise you, I'll give you anything you want. Take a little Jewish boy, 5 years old, first year in yeshiva, and put the judge, and put this little boy, and put a third party, anyone you want, a judge, anyone, to ask questions. Who do you think will win? The little kid will make the judge look like a fool. Not that the judge is stupid. He's 8 years old, a respected judge in the Supreme Court. He learned a lot in his life. He's not a fool. But when it comes to Judaism, he doesn't know anything. Zero. All his life, he invested his time and energy, but not 1 hour of his life went for the purpose of life. Nothing. He doesn't even know what he lives for. He made many millions. Many people kiss his hand. Many people bow down to him. Many people buy his books. That's really it. Ask him, dear judge, what's the purpose of life? To be successful, to be educated, to get married and have children, to go on vacation, to be the best athlete, to invent things. What's the purpose of life? He doesn't know. What do you want from me? Well, how am I supposed to know the purpose of life? Then you ask the judge, do you believe that somebody designed you with your brain, with your eyes, with your nose, with your hands, with nails, with veins, with nerve system, with heart, such a pump, heartbeat? Just this system alone is better than any computer you ever had. All the brain of a person, do you know how sophisticated it is? All the telecommunication companies in the world combined with all the cell phones and Google and Facebook lines and everything. It's not 1% of a brain of one person. One person. already is 100 times more sophisticated than the entire network in the world. And you ask the judge, do you think someone made you? He's intelligent, he's not a fool. He's gonna say, yes, someone had to design such a machine. I don't know who he is, but yeah, I believe there is a creator. You ask the judge, or the lawyer, or the doctor, I wanna ask you a question. Do you think, did you ever see that somebody ever invented something and made it for no purpose? Can you point in one creation that was made for nothing? The light has a purpose? Yes. This chandelier has a purpose. This camera has a purpose? Has a purpose. This microphone has a purpose? Has a purpose. A little 1 penny paper plate has a purpose? Anyone in the world can swear that this paper plate was made by a random explosion? There was an explosion in a forest. The trees were grinded. White color came out of nowhere, made it flat. All these beautiful lines, and the circle was cut by itself. There's another circle inside. There's one on the other side. It was all made by itself for no reason. If somebody will say such thing, put him in a mental house. It's not normal, right? How much? 1 penny. 1 penny, there's not one person in the world that would claim that it made by itself. But the same people that will kill you if you say that this penny was made by itself, they say that the whole world was made by itself. So where is the logic? Ask any professor. You come to the court, they want to put you in prison for life. You tell the judge, I walked on the street, there was an explosion in a garbage can, all kinds of pieces started to fly. This piece was made, it flew into my face, it blocked my views, and I hit the man and I killed him on the road. It's not my fault. So what is the judge gonna say? Usually I'm giving people like you 25 years in prison, but for your chutzpah I'm gonna add another 10 years. So yeah, you're gonna say to the judge, I don't understand, why are you getting angry at me? You don't believe me that there was an explosion in a garbage can and this play was made by itself and it came from the window of my car right into my face and blocked my view? Why you don't believe me? The judge will say, the chance that something like this will happen is 1 to 700 million. That something like this will happen randomly. Basically, it doesn't exist. That's beyond reasonable doubt. You're going to prison for the rest of your life. Then you will ask the judge, dear judge, you wrote in your book that the whole world was made by a random explosion. Who is dumber, me or you? You want to put me in prison for 35 years? You have to put yourself 35 billion years in prison. Because I only say something stupid once. You say billions of times. You said that the brain was made by itself, the eye, the camera was made by itself, stones were made by themselves, everything was made by itself, the galaxies, the moon, the sun, everything was made by itself. Do you really believe that somebody believed that it was made by itself? Why people speak such nonsense? Why big professors write in their book that there were billions of explosions and one of them worked out and the world became? Why they write such stupid things if they don't believe in what they say? Why? Who can tell me why? Anyone here knows why? The same people that wrote this science book in our generation, if they will hear me talking about the plate, they will say this guy is crazy. But they wrote things that are a million times worse. Why nobody called them crazy? Why people buy their books? Why people go to their sessions in a university? The answer is, all the stupid claims, right away most people will know that they are stupid. When it comes to thing against God, people are blind. Why? The answer, because there is such thing called evil inclination. Evil inclination, yetzer hara. And the job of the evil inclination that God put in the heart of every person is to convince you always to do the opposite of the truth. To steal, to cheat, to lie, to hit. All these things that people do comes from the evil inclination. Before we finish, maybe I'll give you some time for questions if you have. I just want to conclude what I started with. Once the Jews stood in Mount Sinai and they received the Torah from God, the Torah told us, I created you body and soul. Vayitzer Hashem Elokim et Adam afar min ha'adamah. Hashem made the person sand from the ground. Vayipach be'apav nishmat chayim. He blew into his nostril a living soul. Vayi ha'adam lenefesh chaya. And the person became a living creature. Meaning before the soul came into the body, the person was not alive. Even though he had a body, the body couldn't move, the body couldn't talk. Once the soul came into the body, we became alive. And the Torah also say how a person die. Very simple. The same soul that came in goes out. And the body falls on the ground, because without the soul, the body cannot function. Once the soul came out, the person died. What happened to the soul? Okay, the soul came out, the body is on the floor. Tomorrow the body will be inside the ground. But where did the soul go? The Torah say, V'aneshama tashuv lebe'aleha ki hu netana. And the soul returned to its owner that put it in that body. So the soul returns back to God. For what? Not to eat lunch with him. Not for that. For what? For a trial. How long trial? 1 year. That's why we say Kaddish on people that died in Judaism, 1 year. 1 year we say Kaddish. It's no coincidence that it's 1 year. It could have been 2 weeks. It could have been 20 years. Who decided that it's exactly 1 year? The Torah say, 1 year he needs our help desperately. He needs lawyers. He needs people to help him. He needs good witnesses. The more good you do in the world for your father or your mother or your brother or your son or whatever it is, lo aleinu, the more you ease the judgment from this person. Plus, every year there is a review in his file. When? The day he died. If he died on the first day of the month of Nisan, every year, the month of Nisan, on the first day, that's the review of his file. Let's see what happened in the world thanks to you or for you. What does it mean, thanks to you? For instance, if when you were rich, when you live in the world, and you had a friend that he could not put his kid in yeshiva, he couldn't afford $1,000 a month, and you were very rich, and you saw that your friend is suffering a lot, he doesn't want to send his kid to a public school, so you decided that you're going to do a good thing, and you're going to pay the tuition. So you paid 10 years, you send this boy to yeshiva, he became very religious, then you died, and then this boy continued with his learning and became a very big rabbi. He writes book, he teaches Torah, he makes a lot of people change for the better. Even after a person died, the fact that he built him up with his money, he became a partner in everything good that will come out of this boy is in his entire life. So therefore, if Reuven was sponsoring this boy Shimon, and already Reuven passed away from the world, 1 year after he passed from the world, Hashem opened back his file. Let's see what happened in the world thanks to you. What does it mean, thanks to you? You build a yeshiva, you build a synagogue, you gave money for kids to go to good yeshiva to learn to become real kosher Jews. These people, everything they do positive in the world goes to your account, even if you're dead already. Every year you earn more and more and more. That's the good news. What's the bad news? It could be the same thing, but the opposite. If the kid was in yeshiva and you brainwash him, you fool. What are you doing in yeshiva? What is it going to help you all your life to learn Torah? Go to college. Become a professor. And the kid went to college. and slowly, slowly he forgot about religion, and then he stopped keeping Shabbat, and then he met Christine and married her, and then he converted to a different religion, and then he put his kids in different school, nothing to do with Judaism. And then when he died, he said, I don't want you to bury me. I want you to burn my body and give it to the fish in the aquarium. And that was the end of this boy. Who has to pay for all this tragedy? The person that took him out of yeshiva. Every bad thing that this kid would do until the day he dies, and his children and grandchildren, until the end of this world, this person will be punished for each one of these things. This is how it works. You save a soul, you will be rewarded for eternity. You destroy a soul, you will be punished for eternity. This is how it goes. I didn't make the rules. I only came to tell you what the rules are. That's all. But I promise you, nobody asked me, hey, Mr. Mizrachi, you have any opinion here? Should we make it better or worse? Maybe I don't remember that God asked me, should I change the law? Do you think it's too strict? Maybe I should be nicer. Maybe I should go easier on people. Maybe I should give them more than what I do. Tell me your opinion. It never happened, not even in my dreams. Definitely not in reality. I want everyone to understand the fact that we gather every year and we say nice things for the person and we make bracha when we eat the food and we invite the rabbi to say divrei Torah for his soul. And people remember, one day people will have to come and speak for me. I won't be here forever. It reminds a person about where we all going to end, soon or later. It's not in our hand. Today we're here, tomorrow we don't know where we are. So therefore it makes people wake up. When the speaker comes and he speaks in a yahrzeit, in a memorial day, You understand, when people speak about it, it makes people, especially children and the wife and the brothers and sisters, it makes them make repentance. Look at my life, I live in a lie. Maybe it's really time for me to wake up and start keeping Shabbat and eat kosher and dress modest. Maybe it's time to move my children from public school into a good kosher yeshiva to save them before it's too late. Before I would lose them, like 70-80% of the Jews lose their children after they send them to public school. They all leave Judaism and disappeared, and they destroy their neshamot because they try to save a few dollars every month. Maybe I won't fall into this statistic. Maybe it's time to wake up. Some Jews, they appreciate to hear the truth, even if it's not pleasant. Same thing, you go to the doctor and he tells you you must lose 50 pounds. Oh no. 50 pounds? You serious? Yes, minimum 50. And you have 3 months to do it. And you're not allowed this, and you're not allowed this, and you have to run, and you have to do this, and you have to do that, and you cannot eat that. Nobody likes to hear it. But most smart people would kiss the hand of the doctor. Thank you, doctor, for opening my eyes to my situation. Thank you for putting me in a surgery room. Thank you for locking me in. Thank you for giving me shots. Thank you for changing my entire life. Thank you for making it so much harder than what it was. Why thank you? You should give him a smack, not thank you. The reason why you're thanking him, because you understand that he wants to save your life before it's too late, right? But when it comes to rabbis, most people somehow don't understand that. The doctor is a doctor of the body. The rabbis, they are the doctor of the soul. Body and soul, what's more important, the body or the soul? Without the soul, the body worth exactly $2. $2, some minerals, iron, salt, water, some other ingredients, the entire body, $2. If somebody got hit by a car, his family sue for $2? Imagine the lawyer, the defense, comes from the insurance company and say, Your Honor, objection. Why sue for $80 million? Because your client was texting and driving and he killed him. The family is devastated. You have to pay $80 million. So the lawyer will say, I'm sorry. Why $80 million? The damage is only $2. $2. Some salt, some mineral, some of the other thing, all together, that's the damage. Why you want $80 million? How would the judge look at the lawyer? He say, I don't know how you became a lawyer, but you're not coming back to my courtroom. Why? You need a mental institution. What kind of a claim you making? So the lawyer will ask the judge, I'm sorry, judge, can you prove that the person that died was worth more than $2? Who can say that the body worth more than $2? How can you prove it? How can you prove it? Diamond, you can prove. Furniture, you can prove. Electronic device, you can prove. How can you prove that the body of a person worth X amount of money? The answer, any amount of money cannot pay for one human being. Because it's a divine soul. Can you put a price on it? Can you put a price on something divine? So the conclusion is, this gathering in the Yahrzeit and the funeral and the Kaddish and all these things that we do come from the Book of God. This is to comfort the people that died. It makes them feel very good when they see that their children continue to think about them and they continue to give them respect. But the most important thing is when they do positive things in the world for them. That's much more important than eating food. You understand? Bezrat Hashem, I'm going to leave now because I have another lecture. But David will follow me in a car. Bezrat Hashem. And I'm going to give him some CDs for you. Don't leave. Continue the meal and enjoy. In 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you're going to have free CDs here. Please don't leave without taking them. We'll give you the purpose of life, life after death, what Shabbat is. Please use it. What do you care? You got a free gift. Put it in the car. Listen. Educate yourself. Make your life better. Thank you very much. Kol Tov.